So we'll go ahead and get on into this material again. As we get into things, I wanted to point out that I made a mistake, and I had Dr. David Curry here filming the other day, and I went up to him because I can't be an expert on everything. I'm not a geneticist, and in fact, I know what I said was wrong because I went up to him and I said, everything accurate? He's like, one thing. I misspoke, and I was talking about deoxyribonucleic acids, and I said these little four that were bonded together were proteins. Of course, they're not. They're nucleic acids. They code for protein production. And so if somebody was in here and they knew that was the case and they knew I misspoke, please feel free to speak up. I am not threatened in any way, shape, or form by people's knowledge. If I make a mistake, I don't want to send that out to a bunch of people wrong. Just go, that what you meant to say was nucleic acids, not proteins. And I would go, yes, thank you very much, and fix that right away. So the genetic information, you know, I went and so gene codes for protein, right? And that might result in identifiable traits, but it's genes and not traits that are inherited. And so, you know, I pointed this out the other day. These critical periods, the teratogens we talked about and their effects. And I said that the embryonic stage is one of the most vulnerable critical periods. That's the embryo phase prior to transition to the fetus. But the fetus is still vulnerable till you're born. And then once you're born, you're vulnerable too, right? So you got to keep in mind that we all are biological entities, and a biological entity can suffer physical damage at any given point, that it might have all kinds of possible outcomes. And remember way back when I started talking about how you won the cosmic lottery by being born at all? Because the odds are stacked against it so heavily in the cosmos itself, but then here on Earth, the time frame we live, and we talked about how you can take somebody in industrialized medicine society and they're 5 months old and you can help them live through heroic medical efforts that didn't even exist, you know, 100 years ago, 50 years ago, the access to it still doesn't exist to a lot of places. But just the fertilization of the sperm and the egg, about 2 out of 5 times doesn't actually implant. And all those that implant do not make it to term. So it's rough getting here. You won the lottery. But sometimes it don't feel like a winning ticket. Sometimes rough life comes afterwards and we're wondering about it. So this is where we left off. The critical periods, talking about substances when we're talking about teratogens, which means we're talking about molecules that cross the placental barrier and can then affect the unborn organism at whatever stage it may be in. And then some of those molecules are obviously drugs, because if they can affect you mentally, in other words, if you can feel the effects of them, they can affect your brain, then they're passing through the blood-brain barrier, which is more restrictive than the placental barrier, which has to let in much larger molecules like nutrients, right? Bigger molecules. Maternal illness then is another type of teratogen. And what are we talking about here? Germs, right? Bacteria and viruses. So if they can cross the placental barrier, they can affect the developing organism at whatever stage it may be in, and the damage it can do can greatly depend on what stage it is in. Keeping in mind that many people don't even know they're pregnant. Women are people too. Y'all see that CoverGirl ad that came out that says women can, girls can. I like that because it shows quite clearly everything women have been allowed to do in the last 100 years, they've been able to do. They just hadn't been allowed to do everything. But one thing they do for all of us is make all of us. So behind every great man is a woman, literally wouldn't exist without it. But here we have the fact that the mother's biological system is interacting with the unborn organism's biological system in such a way that it could cause damage if teratogens are to cross those barriers. And if you don't know you're pregnant at the most critical time, you may not know to quit smoking or to quit drinking or to quit using particular drugs, and you certainly don't control when you get sick. And certain kinds of diseases, measles and others, will have very negative effects. And here are a couple that are really damaging. Herpes and AIDS can be transmitted via contact with the mother's fluids during birth. So baby's born, it's got eyes, it's got mouth, it's got nasal membranes, right? It's got ways in which viruses can be transmitted. And so herpes via lesion contact, AIDS via blood contact. Herpes can give us a child that has microcephaly, small head growth, paralysis, deafness, blindness, brain damage, and possibly death. That's hardcore. AIDS. 30% of mothers with AIDS pass the disease, and the progress is rapid in infants because they don't have developed immune systems that are being attacked that you can then shore up with a cocktail of drugs that help to bolster the immune system. They don't have hardly any kind of immune system whatsoever, which is why it's important to use breast milk if you can use breast milk, because you're transmitting antibodies to help build up the immune system of the infant. So you have all these kind of factors impinging on the outcome on a biological level that then translates into a life experience of some kind or another. So preventing these things is important. Access to prenatal care is critical, but not everybody has that kind of access. So here you got this very straightforward system. You got maturing follicles releasing eggs, going out over here into the fallopian tubes. Now you got the penis, right? Right here. At certain times in life, I hope it's a loving occasion, right? I hope it's a committed occasion, but it's going to go up and down until it goes spurt. And when it spurts, we're talking about millions of sperm. Millions of sperm going after theoretically one egg, but more than one egg could be released, correct? Right? And people go to fertilization treatment, sometimes have triplets or quadruplets or six triplets or seven triplets or eight triplets or nine triplets because they got extra eggs released. And all those sperm are still there. So as many eggs as are out there to be fertilized, they may be fertilized. But that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be an organism. Start out with your old zygote. You got coming fertilization, fascinating, all sperm going after it. One penetrates the egg, and then the egg sets up a force field. In a way, right, metaphorically, and it keeps the others out. So you've got one egg, one sperm fusing, right? We got 46 chromosomes, 23 from father, 23 from mother, blending together in kind of a crapshoot random fashion. It's not totally random because you have the genetic heritage of the entire lineage of the organism that are coming to bear here potentially. And then you get fertilization and you're now back to one single cell, which is fascinating, right? And then it's two, and it's four, and it's eight, and it goes on and on. Then we got a blastocyte, and then we got morula turning into blastocyte, and then it's off through the fallopian tubes, and hopefully it doesn't get implanted there and keep on dividing, because then you can get what? Tubal pregnancy, which could be a threat, obviously, to the unborn organism, but also to the mother's health. Right, so then you're hoping it travels on down. And what is this menses that women have to deal with month after month after month? Well, the body is set up to create a receptive environment for fertilization in the uterus. So you have this uterine lining building up. And if no fertilization occurs in a monthly fashion, it sloughs off, and that is the discharge that women have to deal with. Men don't know shit about and shouldn't say nothing about except, may I help you? How may I be of service to you? Because thank you, women, for doing this for us. But if you got implantation, everything goes well, you still don't got guaranteed birth. Right? At that point, mother's not aware she's pregnant. We're talking about days, and then we're talking about the first few weeks, and we transmit that information and realize this is the source of our debates. Keep in mind, everybody's got a point of view. Just because you hold yours tightly doesn't make it rightly. Everybody in America's got a right to their opinion and to express it. And it would be nice if they had compassion and respect for other people's opinions, because then you could have a much nicer debate, just as passionate, because people's values matter. But no, on the other side, when we look up here, that's your first baby picture. Look how cute you are. You're so cute. That's a little baby. It's a little baby. And then you become this cute thing. And at this point, you can see it's kind of debatable. Is that a human being? Well, it's certainly the seeds of a human being. No human being that exists doesn't go through that phase. But that's the debate. And I'm not answering the debate because I don't claim to have the answer. I don't know the definitive thing. I think that would be a more intellectually honest position for a lot of people to take. I can respect people's positions on it, but I don't have a definitive answer. And no matter how much they believe they have a definitive answer, it is debatable or it wouldn't be debated. And that's becoming more clearly human-like. Look like a little kidney bean with an eyeball. And now we see that, right? We got the amniotic sac, and you're underwater. You're a sea creature. You're floating around up, and you're flying around in here. Woo! And we can inject a little needle right into here and pull out a little bit of that amniotic fluid and do some genetic testing. And you can decide whether or not a number of things are going to happen, whether it's going to be genetically male or genetically female. The sex of the baby can't be determined, and in some ways may be the basis of some kinds of selective abortions, which is highly debatable about the morality of that. All right, but there are also societal pressures in some spaces in the world, particularly to have male children, and there always have been. Males have always been favored over females. It's not right from my view, but that's my view. Other places, that's the way it is. But you can also look into other kinds of chromosomal damage or potential chromosomal damage and potential for birth defects. And you can predict from that, not with perfect accuracy, but with probabilities, what are the likely outcomes of having this baby come to term and be born? And is it going to be devastating in terms of its physical abilities, or is it not likely to be, or can you not tell at all? Those are pieces of information that human beings get, and they have to understand and deal with it, and frankly, many of them don't understand it. But then we get up to here, and we're looking at a fetus, that's pretty clearly looking like a person now. We got little arms forming, little hands forming, little legs, right? And that's the phase, at the embryonic phase, that thalidomide, y'all familiar with thalidomide? It's a drug to stop morning sickness that was used fairly widely in Britain, I believe in the 50s. And they hadn't done widespread testing on humans. They just found it stopped morning sickness. But what it also stopped was the formation of limbs in children. And so they would have limb buds that did not develop fully into arms and legs. And though they were crudely called flipper babies. And it was only after noticing patterns of this happening that they started to put two and two together that the drug was actually causing this. So it was a benevolent thing. Who wants to live through morning sickness? I never will have to, but I certainly wouldn't want to have to if I was a woman pregnant. And they found a drug that they thought helped, but it actually damaged pretty, devastatingly the unborn organism. So now we're getting up into here and moving forward, you know, we got your placenta and umbilical cord. There's your first baby picture that most people are familiar with, the sonogram, right? Those are really accurate, aren't they? Kind of, sort of. I took one of my son today, he was born, he said, I think he might be about 8 pounds. I'm like, well, he looks like he might be bigger now. He was 10 pounds, 4 ounces. So they were off by a factor of, 25% or so. But it did give us a picture. And so you can see pretty gross, in the sense gross, meaning really just rough details. You're using sonar technology to create a picture outside on a screen of what's going on inside. And then you get born, and we got to cut that umbilical cord. There it is right here. May not be able to see it hanging off there. Cut it, tie it off, and poke it in. You got an innie, leave it out. You got an outie, belly button. Isn't that crazy? All your nutrients and all your waste in this lifeline. And now you're out. You don't need it anymore. Shoop, boop, and you're done with that. Good luck, because the world's a wild place. But even if you get born really, really, really early, you might be able to make it if you're in the right place in the world with the right access to the right care. That's hardcore if you think about all that stuff. That's why this is relevant to human development and psychology in general.